Rob Sharp.
Meet the mics. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this morning's Coffee Time Show. On today's episode, we have Elko Meyers, who runs the Graffiti Coffee Ride. Elko, welcome onto the show.
Thank you, Miles. Good to be here.
You have an incredible story, and I'm so excited to unpack this one. There's so many things on the table, and it really, really is an incredible story of how everything came about and how you started cycling.
Yes.
So guys, we are live from Cycle Lab in Four Ways. So please, if you have any questions, please drop them in the live Facebook feed, and we can get Elko to answer your questions. Elko, so who is Elko Meyers? With no disrespect, you are the oldest person that's come onto our show. So at least you take
that
prize.
I'm honored. Okay.
So who's Elko?
Yes, all right. I'm a retired person. I've been around. Okay.
The mic. Just flip down there.
Is it all right?
Let's try again.
I'm a retired. I basically hitchhiked across Africa when I was 20 years old. And I spent 35 years in the advertising industry. I loved it. It was very exciting. I always enjoyed doing adventurous things.
Do you have any tips for us with your 35 years experience?
A little bit. But at any rate, one thing led to another. And I'm married and I have a daughter living in France. And she's the one who got me into cycling. Yeah.
Got you into cycling. And when did you get into cycling? Because I think that's a story on its own. You only got into cycling when you were 59 years old.
Yeah, I was 59 and I was putting on weight. I haven't lost any weight, but still. And she said, "Dad, let's ride the 94.7. So we rode the 94.7. And that was fantastic, and we finished it, and after that we did a couple of Cape Arguses, that's what it was called, and we crossed the line together, and it was just an amazing relationship builder and a fantastic opportunity. So she introduced me to cycling at 59 in 2009.
Elko, we were chatting about it just now. There's people racing the Cape Epic at the sharp end of the field, trying to go as fast as they can. And us last weekend, riding around Johannesburg, looking at the most famous and most beautiful graffiti I don't even know what you call it. It's a graffiti
spectacle.
Street
art,
street art.
I call it graffiti art treasures of Johannesburg, because we have some of the very, very best graffiti writers in the world.
Really?
And our top guys, they fly all over the world. Our number one graffiti writer, she's in fact done work in 36 countries. It's a lady who grew up in, Faith 47 is her name.
Okay.
And she grew up in Cape Town and then, has now done work all over the world.
Elko, how did this become an idea and how did it start? I mean, obviously you have a massive passion for it as well. So.
Yeah, I do. I majored at history of art and I did fine art at university. I was always interested in art as a kid.
Wow.
And what really happened is that with the 94.7, eventually I wanted to do the Argus, so I decided to ride from Joburg down to Cape Town and see what it was like for the adventure.
So we're just showing some scenes from last weekend's ride. So you guys start at Dunkeld Centre?
Yes, we start at Dunkeld.
By the Four Nose Bakery?
At Four Nose Bakery, and that's on Sundays. It started off for the first Sunday of the month, and then it's now we're doing 3-4 Sundays a month. You know, the demand has just grown in leaps and bounds.
And we joined this group, known as the BK
Cranksters. This was the BK Cranksters. They're guys that live in Kempton Park area, and they this is their second tour that they've done. They did the first one to Melville, and the second tour, this is the Masterpieces route, which goes to Newtown and Bromfontein.
How many routes do you have?
We've got three routes. The first one is to Melville and West End, which is like a sort of a pipe opener and getting people into it.
Yes.
And we don't need motorbikes for that particular ride, but that goes into Melville and West End. And the West End story is a beautiful story because it's really a student community.
Okay.
And students want to live in fancy digs and fancy places, and so the graffiti writers have done the work. That's Miriam Makeba. It's in town, in Newtown. And
so you kind of have three routes?
Three routes, and then the third route goes to Mabaneng.
Okay.
But that's the longest route. That's 40Ks, and that people have to be fittest for that.
Sure.
You need to be pretty fit for that particular.
Elko, one concern for me, I mean, especially before we went onto the ride, going into Newtown, going to Bromfontein, I was a bit skeptical about safety, yes. But obviously there was actually absolutely no issues. You've never had any issues.
Yes.
And obviously having the road rangers there is a massive, massive selling point for the ride as well.
Yes, I think that, you know, with my endurance riding, I was always very conscious of safety. Mm. And I mean, things that are very naffy for most people, like mirrors. I put a mirror on my bike, a little traditional mirror on the side of it, and I can tell you that it saved my life not once but umpteen times.
Wow.
And it's just $250 and probably the best $250 you could spend on an endurance bike.
Wow.
And so to get back to safety, that's critical. Before we do the graffiti rides, I brief everyone on what the safety measures are going to be, what we're doing. We stop at traffic lights and we don't cut corners, stop streets. And if people want to do that, I'll ask them to ride back on their own and they can go through as many red robots as they like. And so nobody, I haven't had to do that to anyone. But here and there, you know, people forget the rules and then I have to remind them that during the ride, their safety is in my hands.
The ride that we did on Sunday, it was 24 kilometers, but it ended up being almost 4 hours long. So that really does give an indication of, of how much we stop and how much you dive into all the different pieces of art and all the artists themselves as well, which, I mean, I was blown away just to hear that an artist would get paid 600,000 rand to do a piece of work on a building. And they're literally world famous. Our South African guys are world famous and they come from previously disadvantaged backgrounds and some don't. Some people come from wealthy communities as well.
Yes.
So let's just break it down. I mean, just if break it down on how someone becomes a street tagger to actually becoming an artist. Can you just,
okay,
just kind
yeah.
of...
Look, amongst the purists, there's a difference between a graffiti writer and a street artist. A graffiti writer really starts off by tagging the walls. In other words, they're just putting their signature on there.
And
they're
that's spraying. Known as vandalism.
And that's, well, if it's, yes, it's known as vandalism because they're not getting permission from the landowner to do the work. So they're just signing their name or initial, their street name or, you know, onto the wall. Then what happens is they progress, they get better and better and they learn how to do portraits and they may learn how to do animals and learn how to write their name, hide their name in the walls, etc. Wild style writing, as that's called.
Wow.
But the street artist is somebody who comes in and doesn't go through all those ranks of tagging and bubble letters and wild style and so on. He comes in or she comes in and just hits the runway running, where they are able to paint spectacular walls without having to go through all the basics. They just have that kind of talent.
Wow.
There are guys like Nomad came in through that without having to do all the tagging and bombing, as they call it. And a guy like Sonny, who's today in New York, he's done work for the United Nations.
Wow.
He
South African guy.
South African guy.
So they fly him to New York.
He lives in LA now.
Oh wow!
He left.
So
he left 2 months ago.
Yes.
And he did the elephant that you saw on Sunday.
Okay.
Okay. That work. So he hit the decks running. He didn't do any tagging. He didn't spend an apprenticeship on the roads.
Yeah.
So amongst the graffiti writers, they see him as a street artist and not as a writer.
Sure.
And why do they call them writer? Because they write their names, all right? The graffiti writers started by signing their names.
Wow.
Okay, and then they progressed to doing other things.
Sure.
But a guy like Jason Sunny, he just could paint wildlife. He's sponsored by the World, you know, Discovery Channel.
Sure.
And he grew up in Kailani. I mean, his work is spectacular.
Incredible.
That's wild style. That's a bit of wild style work.
So that's called
Mars.
Wild style. Mars.
Yes,
his name.
Mars is probably one of the top wild style writing. What they do there is they hide their name in the wall. So, you know, they will know amongst themselves who that is. With time, you do get to know, you know, who's doing what. They hero worship Taps. He's the most notorious graffiti writer in South Africa.
Taps.
Taps, T-A-P-Z, there you go. Okay.
This is him.
That's him on the toilets in Newtown. On the left there is De Bongs, very, very good with portraits. He
De
just
Bongs.
Flew over, by the way. That's
Jake's
Mabela.
That's Jake's.
De Bongs flew over to New York. He was invited by Charlize Theron to actually, it was a cultural exchange, to do work in New York, paint some walls, along with a guy called Senzo.
Wow. I think this is another piece of Jake's
work. That's Jake's Mabela. That's in.
It's actually in the parking lot. We went
in
down
parking
into a parking lot
down there,
to get that
downstairs
photo.
In in a new town. And very good guy, a hell of a nice guy too. Top portrait guy. There are a couple of guys that really, really know how to do portraits, and he's certainly one of them.
There's this one guy you said he's the most famous graffiti artist in the world.
The most famous graffiti artist in the world is Banksy.
All right,
Banksy, B-A-N-K-S-Y.
Okay.
And he's popularized graffiti. And maybe if you've got something here that you can show.
Yeah, so we do have that auction that you told me to download. So let's just play that video for the viewers, and then they can get a good idea of who Banksy is.
Who we're talking about, and then why he became so famous and so on.
Art connoisseurs could only watch in horror as an expensive piece was shredded before their eyes. No sooner did the gavel come down to mark the sale of Banksy's Girl with Balloon for a record $1.4 million, did the picture start to slip out of its frame into shreds below. The anonymous artist claims to be behind the stunt. On Instagram, he posted a photo of his prank with the caption, "Going, going, gone." In a later post, he explained how he did it. And it seems this stunt was years in the making. He claims he built the shredder into the painting's frame in case it ever sold at auction.
$400,000, $600,000, your bid's $600,000. Last chance. And selling for
$860,000. Witnesses couldn't believe what they were seeing. We can only imagine what the buyer was thinking. The person's identity hasn't been revealed. Sotheby's claims it was shocked by the stunt. The auction house is also trying to figure out what this means for the value of the painting. Considering the artist, who is known for using his craft to pull pranks and make ideological points, some artists speculate the value of Girl with Balloon could actually soar. For InsideEdition.com, I'm Mara Montalbano.
So that's Banksy's work. Maybe just give us a little bit of history and story behind that.
Very quick is that graffiti, they say all graffiti dies. It disappears off the streets with time.
Okay.
All right, it's not eternal.
Yeah.
And when he was playing with the audience there, he put that work up there. And when the buyer put in the bid for $1.4 million, that was in 2018,
wow,
he pressed the button and it shredded the work. And then he had to test the guy whether he still liked the work, yes or no.
Uh-huh.
Well, he took the work and he put it on auction 3 weeks ago now, and he got $24 million for it.
Wow, so he's the most world
famous. So he's the world's most famous. So what Banksy has done is he's brought graffiti into the mainstream, and more people know about it, and he's popularized it and made it far more acceptable.
What's his following on Instagram?
His following is 11 million.
11 million.
And he doesn't follow a single person. He's given the world the middle finger.
Yeah. That's brilliant.
And nobody knows him either.
That's
brilliant. He's totally invisible.
That's insane.
Okay.
I love it.
All right.
There's no face to old Banksy.
Okay.
But let's just go back to Faith 47, because there's also some history behind this.
Faith 47 grew up in the Cape and in the 80s and the 90s. And today she's based also in LA in the US.
Okay.
She's our most famous. She's got 80,000 followers on Instagram.
Okay.
Because you don't have a monetary value to the work, I suppose the other way to look at, you know, who's the most famous is who's got more Instagram followers than anyone else.
Yeah, of course.
And she travels all over the world. She's done work in 36 countries. She's really become a multidisciplinary artist. So she's moved off the streets, but she still works on the streets as well. She did a 18-story building in Philadelphia last year, and she's scared of heights. That's Dredda.
This is one of my favorite pieces on the ride.
Right.
So so we're bringing this back
to
cycling, and I must say the ride is very safe. Cycle Lab do have a van that comes, so
it
if anyone wants to jump in the car, if someone's feeling a bit tired, they can still get in the car and experience all the different pieces of art.
Yeah, it's
on the
fantastic.
Road.
You know, it's peace of mind. If a puncture, we don't stop and repair punctures. We just load the bike and then do it at the coffee stop.
Brilliant.
Know?
And we're also linking this back to cycling. I mean, I got the privilege to be able to ride this beautiful KTM e-bike over the weekend, my very first ride on an e-bike. And I must say, it was a very cool experience. I'm definitely
Well, you were the only one along with myself, and everyone else was riding normal bikes.
Exactly.
You
know. I was a bit I was a bit stunned when I got there to the coffee shop. Everyone was on normal bikes. I thought I was going to ride away from them.
Yeah, I know. It was fantastic.
It was just a great day out to go and experience Joburg, the heart of Johannesburg, and see these incredible pieces of art.
Yeah. Look, you know, e-bikes are making it easy. Johannesburg's a very hilly city, unlike, you know, places like London and Paris and Amsterdam, etc. You need for somebody who's not, I'm an average Joe rider. I mean, even though I've ridden a bike from Cape Town to Vic Falls twice, I still see myself very much as a back-end rider, average Joe.
Sure.
And I enjoy my e-bike going up and down the hills. You know, I did it on a normal bike, so now...
So, that was actually one of my questions. If someone books a ride, do they have to come on an e-bike?
No. They can ride them. I mean, like on Sunday, all the participants were on normal bikes.
Yeah.
But what's happening now too is you're getting some rides with mixed, where half of them are e-bikes and some are normal. My job is to make sure that everyone is happy, that everyone's enjoying it, that they're having an experience of a lifetime. Yeah. And, you know, I'm sharing the story of, you know, street art.
Unbelievable. And I mean, it's your passion. It's your passion
very,
as well.
Very, very much so.
You have put all your art, well, pictures that you kind of see into these amazing books.
Yes.
So these are coffee table books. It's called Graffiti South Africa. And there's also
This is one by Street Art Africa. And I just wanted to show you this.
I mean, it's incredible.
She's being featured. She went, and by the way, to Barack Obama. She was invited by Barack Obama in the US. Also from the Cape, grew up in the Cape Flats. That's her work there. And right now, as of 2 days ago, her work is now sold on coffee tins and biscuits that you can buy at Woolworths.
So this is a biscuit tin sold in Woolworths, and this artist has now got her art on the tin.
And I think that's incredible. And she did work in front of Barack Obama. So you'll think twice about South African lady. Our work is really, really world class. You know,
unbelievable.
I don't know how you can open this, unless if you want to get a biscuit.
You might have to have a drink. No, go for it. Yeah, let's open some biscuits here. So, Alko, anything else about the e-bike ride that you want to speak about? Because there's actually another topic we just want to dive into, and you have a wealth of knowledge about e-bikes as well.
Yes.
So there's a few questions I have for you there.
Yeah, all right. No, look, I think e-bikes, as far as I'm concerned, when I finished riding for the second time to Vic Falls and crossing the Nabu Desert, I saw Falco's work. And that, I thought, maybe I should come back. I didn't know it was Falco's work, but I should come back and become an ambassador for graffiti.
Okay.
But at the same time, also try and make it easy, because having done, cycled and got to Vic Falls the second time, I thought, where to from here? Mm. And that was in 2017. And I then offered my services to the 94.7. And they allowed me to ride it as their first official guinea pig.
Wow.
So that was one cyclist on an e-bike. Nobody could tell me whether the motors would overheat like an electric drill, whether the battery would last the distance, you know, the 94.7 kilometers. Yeah. Nobody could tell me that. So it was a nerve-wracking ride, but it had to be done.
And ever since then, the technology's come.
Well,
the
technology's moved on, and the interesting thing is that the Cape Town cycle tour that finished two Sundays ago had 194 e-bike finishes.
So events are really starting to accept e-bikes.
E-bikes finishes.
Wow.
So it really is the way it's going. And, you know, anti-e-bike people are going to bury their heads in sand, because they're going to get left behind eventually.
So let me play devil's advocate here to say, if I ride an e-bike, I'm lazy and I'm not going to get fitter.
No, you're not. I need to just, and I'm giving you my perspective.
Please do. I'm just.
My perspective is that your upper body parts will work the same as on a normal bike, if not harder, because the bike is heavier, and so you're carrying more weight that you're nursing and that you're going around corners and doing single track or whatever you want to do.
Yeah.
But your lower part, obviously, your legs are finding it a lot easier because you've got the pedal assist that's helping you. So that's key. So it's easier to pedal, but your top part is working. Your upper body is certainly working.
But also, I mean, it also brings riders of different levels and skill levels closer together.
Okay.
For example, I mean, let's say myself and you want to go ride the Sarnia to sea.
Yes.
We can ride together comfortably and we can both get the same workout.
Yes, very, very much so. That's the fantastic thing about what the category has done, is it's brought people with different skills levels, and you've got so many people that are saying, well, now my brother can ride with me, or my sister can ride with me, or my father, or my mother, or my daughter, or whatever it is. And on the graffiti rides, when you actually see this happening in front of your own eyes, it's amazing to see, you know. And the one's riding a normal bike and the other one's riding an e-bike. But where's it going to go?
Well, that's the next question I'm going to ask. Okay. Where do you think e-bikes are going to go in the future?
Well, I think what I would like to see is South Africa become the playground for e-bikes in the world. And I mean it.
Because we have some beautiful trails.
We, not only that, is other than the Tour de France, we have some of the best cycling events in the world, without a shadow of doubt. So why can't we have the best e-bike event in the world? And I think where the real focus could be is on the development of product, battery technology, and motor technology. And the
I think it's only a matter of time before one battery can take you 1,000 kilometers
or 200 kilometers or whatever it is. So in other
words, is the battery life at the moment on an e-bike?
We'll give you 100 k's, 110, depending on how you ride it.
On what setting?
And what setting.
So what I found on Sunday, so I didn't know there were so many settings, to be honest. So you can actually ride with it completely off.
Yes.
And then obviously the battery's being saved. There's eco mode.
Yes.
There's tour mode, sport mode, and then there's
turbo mode. Yes.
And I was very tempted to always put in turbo mode because that's the fastest mode. But then I was seeing the kilometers run down a lot faster. Look, so it's about battery management at the end of the
day. That's what it is. Look, e-bikes give you wings, but you don't want to know what it's like when you've run out of power.
It's just a very, very heavy mountain bike.
That bike is very heavy. Yeah. That bike's very heavy. Okay. You'll only do it once. Look, it's like pushing your car. Yeah. You know, you'll only do it once.
But maybe you should go into some e-bike testing, some battery testing, some endurance testing, see how far and how long we can push these things.
Yes, I think that the opportunity is in this country to actually perfect that and make it some kind of event. You know, the sort of thinking is around maybe the Le Mans kind of endurance, where you start on the Saturday and you end on the Sunday. Well, maybe with the bikes you do it on not 2 days, but you do it over 5, 6, or 7 days, and you do it over 1,000 kilometers or 1,500 kilometers.
Because then, I mean, the battery management skill.
That's where the skill. That's where the ride is.
So, for example, the battery management, that could open a whole other category and a whole other can of worms. Because obviously, to get to the next point, you have to manage your battery.
Yes.
And how many batteries do you carry?
Yes.
When do you charge them? How often do you stop? And that's obviously digging into your time.
And it can be a team building thing too. It can, you know, it can work as a team as a possible option, where you get guys starting and maybe, you know, to stretch the technology further and further, you limit the amount of times that you're allowed to change the battery during the event.
A whole new set of
fun rules of bringing people together, and it shouldn't be for prizes. It shouldn't be have prize money or anything like that. There should be maybe prizes for the technology development, but not for first, second, or third, because people are going to cheat. And then you're going to have scrutineers and all that sort of thing.
I just want to get your feeling on chipping an e-bike, because that's become very popular. Because obviously these bikes, to the viewers who don't know, an e-bike's motor by law needs to cut out at a certain speed.
Yes.
South Africa's limit is 25 kilometers an hour before it becomes a motorbike in a way.
That's correct.
So the motor does cut off at 25 km an hour, and then it becomes your own sort of ability to be able to push the bike further and faster.
Correct. Correct.
What's your feeling on chipping them to be able to get more out of the motor?
Well, I won't say I'm not in favour of it, but first of all, it's the minute you do that, you lose the guarantee on your bike.
Sure.
The other thing is the bike is actually not suitable for use on public roads because it's actually an illegal bike.
Okay.
All right, so the motor's been tampered and all that sort of thing. I don't think any event should, endurance event, should allow chipped bikes in there. It should be a bike that you can buy off the floor.
Yep.
That any person, if they see it and they like the bike and it's done well, can go into the shop floor and buy it. Now, a very important thing now that I've learned 4 years of riding e-bikes is a lot of people know how to sell the bikes, but they don't know how to service them. They really don't. They haven't invested in the after sales, so they don't know. And what's happened now is, like exactly with cars, the motorbike, the motor car mechanic was the hero of the workshop.
Wow.
It's now the auto electrician.
Sure.
What's going to happen with e-bikes, the bike mechanic was the hero, but it's going to be the e-bike technician.
Because it's no longer hardware, it's actually software.
It's software, and it's the guy who can trace the faults. And nowadays, if you go to the right kind of place that knows how to service e-bikes, they can tell you how long you've been riding in this gear, that mode, you name it. They can give you the diagnostics right there and then.
Yeah, it's CycleLab 4S. I know
the facility,
in the
yes.
workshop, he actually specializes in this technology. Yes. He's very knowledgeable.
He knows his stuff and he's really good. Now, that is going to be the difference. How do you select a bike? Mm. Your first consideration must be the after sales. Is it good? Yes or no? And if it's good, then look at the brands that are available in that outlet and say, look, those are the brands that I like. Amazing. And then from there, start looking.
Elko, you mentioned you might be giving away 2 free tickets to one of your rides. Is that still on the table
for some of our viewers? Yes, sure.
How would someone enter that? Do they have to go like your Instagram page? What do you...
Oh, they can have a... You name it and we can work it out. You know, you can maybe ask them a question that was... give 2-3 names and
Who is, guys, question, you can leave it in the comments or you can so it'll be on our Instagram feed as well as this Facebook feed. Who's the most world famous graffiti artist?
Okay, there you go.
And y'all we played it a
and if
video.
You want a second question to split hairs, then who's the most famous South African graffiti artist?
South African. So either one of those two answers and you can let's go at the first two people that answer those one of those two questions, then they will get a free ride on your
free ride
on your coffee ride. Okay. Sorry, before we close off, how does someone book for a ride?
They can either go online.
Okay.
And look
your website?
I've got a website. It's ebikersa.wordpress.com.
They can book on there.
And they can do it there. And also at CycleLab, for example, we've got these flyers. So, people can have a look at it and all the different tours and options that are available are all over here, But online, it's what I've given you there.
And then there's some amazing pictures on your Instagram feed as well.
Yes,
so to the viewers out there, please go like there.
And also on Facebook. Elko Meyers on Facebook.
I think you actually have a bigger platform on Facebook.
Mainly because the riders are a little bit older, you see.
And let's try to get some young folk injected into this.
Yeah, but Instagram you'll see a lot of fantastic work that's available in Johannesburg and in Cape Town.
Brilliant.
You'll really see some great work.
Do you have any Cape Town rides?
Not yet, but
eventually.
They're on the list, the do list. Yeah.
Brilliant. Elko, well, thank you so much for your time.
It's been an amazing morning
chatting about just cycling. I've actually had one. I need to trim down. 947's coming, eh?
Okay.
watching my intake. Is there anything else you'd like to add before we close off?
No, I think it's fantastic. Thank you for the opportunity. It really is...
I just love your passion for art and graffiti and e-bikes. And how much the knowledge you actually have on the motors and the batteries. And I mean, we chatted extensively offline about this and there's some amazing things happening in the pipeline.
It's nice to try and put something back into cycling.
Thank you to all our viewers for watching. Have an amazing weekend riding your bikes out there. Stay safe and we'll see you next week. Cheers, guys.